Yeah, you see the screen?
Yes, we do. It's all yours.
Excellent. Thank you. So, yeah, I'm going to talk about a small research project that I've been working on for a little while, an attempt to basically model contracts in code. So it's perhaps a little bit more restricted and less ambitious project than some of the ones that have been talked about that have a very wide scope, but this is about contracts. Of course, it would be eminently applicable to public procurement contracts, for instance, and therefore play a significant role in making most public procurement more effective and efficient. The project builds on a lot of research and some prior art. For instance, Simon Payton Jones has done some work on creating on modeling financial contracts, and the Poets Project on at Copenhagen University have tried to take that further and expand it into commercial contracts. The example that I'm going to try to show to you today is basically lifted directly from the article that you see here in front of you by Oliver Goodenough. He did that together with a co-author whose name escapes me right now, working for the Treasury Department of the US government a while back. It's basically a very sort of simple loan agreement, and I'm going to try to show you how that can be modeled in code and what you can do when you've modeled a contract like that in code. And I'm going to try to show you two different ways of representing it in code for some definition of code. The classical what people would normally associate with code would be this version. As the programmers or technical people in the audience will see, this is created in a variant of Lisp. Basically, in this system, a contract is defined by a clock, a point in time we observe the contract, a log of events that have happened, and then a contract that has some logic. This element here, down here, is a condition that basically says there is no contract if the event executed has not occurred. There's a preamble that has some prose and some embedded data. There's a discretion that has a window in which it needs to be exercised, and it allows the discretion to, in this case, request a loan, and so on and so forth. So you can imagine the whole loan agreement being modeled in this system. Different way of representing the same thing, and perhaps a more realistic way for non-coders would be something you've actually seen before. If I can just switch to that here, using the Blockly system from Google, you saw actually in the not the last, but the one prior to that presentation, the video, the same system had been used here. It's used to model the contract. So here you see an obligation element that has an obligee and an obligor and a point in time where the obligation is valid and so on. And you can see basically that the system is able to generate this Lisp code on the other side here. And therefore you can build contracts equally sophisticated with this system as the one that I just showed you. So what does all that buy you when you have it? I mean, most people can probably imagine what you can do, but here's the execution environment for the same contract you basically saw just before. That's it's rendered here in the browser and it's running. So if we try to feed it an event, namely the loan request, and say, well, we'll issue that loan request on the specified date down here, you can see the system has analyzed the contract. It says the next expected event to happen is that the loan request is issued. So we'd say, yes, we issue that loan request. And now the contract changes, the state changes. There's a condition down here that's waiting to be fulfilled, namely that the loan is issued by the loan giver. So let's try to do that and do it in a timely manner. Let's just move a few days ahead, just to the spot of it. And you can see the contract changes again, and now it predicts that the loan has to be paid back because somebody has the obligation to do so. And we can continue doing that. We can fail to fulfill obligations, and the contract state will change. It will monitor if declarations or prohibitions are breached or refuted, and it will run these policies that apply to the contract that, for instance, determines whether or not it's terminated and acceleration takes place.
Thank you very much, Martin.
Pretty close to 5 minutes.